This video is about a repair for a Sharp SV3000 stereo system. Now, I've got a bit of personal history with this. I remember my dad having one when we used to live in Hong Kong, probably around 1980. I remember seeing this thing. It played records vertically. It had soft touch buttons where the door, you press a button and the door would just open. It allowed you to put your record in. And it could play both sides of the records without having to turn the record over. It detected the record size as well, I remember that. So if you played an album, it would automatically set the speed to 33. And I remember him having sort of these big headphones on this big sort of glass head. And a microphone as well that you could plug into this thing and record yourself to tape and play back. At that stage I was, I don't know, 7-8 years old, and I just thought it was amazing. So I've been looking out for one of these things for a while. And like most things retro at the moment, they're going for silly prices. But this one came up on eBay, reasonable price. So I made an offer and it was accepted. So off I set to go and pick it up. This was the advert as it was on eBay. It sounded like it was very much loved. Apparently, doing some reading, very typical of these things, that the belts perished over time. And it sounded like this one had similar issues. The picture that was posted made it look quite nice, so I went to get it. Interesting, when I picked it up, the power cable was cut off, which was a little bit strange. The plastic dust cover around the record player was a bit frosty, a bit opaque, like it had been in the sun for some time, and it had a fair share of marks on it as well. But all in all, a nice system, just not quite the cherished system that I was hoping for from the advert. It did come with a manual though. It was a nice touch, a little bit tatty and ripped, but again, this thing's 40 years old, so just to see a manual was quite nice. Got it home, and first thing to do was set about obviously putting a plug on it, but the cable had been cut so short that the cable itself wasn't of much use, so it actually needed a whole new cable putting on. So that was the first thing to do, is to put a brand new power cable onto this thing. The back comes off fairly easy. It's I'm not quite sure what the material's called, but it's like a combination of cardboard and wood that you used to find on most stereos back then. So it's just held in by a number of different screws. One interesting thing on the back of this is that there was a voltage selector. So I was wondering about how we used to run it in Hong Kong. Did we have one that was at a different voltage? But this actually allows you to select 110, 220, 240 volts just by rotating that screw that you just saw. So once the back's off, the mains cable is coming into the bottom of the machine. Replacing this, because as you can see, there's not much length on the cable at all to be of any use, so it needs to come off. It comes into that little section there. It's just soldered in place between the cable coming in and then going off into the rest of the machine. There's a fuse there in line, and there's a number of fuses around the machine as well. Tested the fuse was good, so I just wanted to replace the cable with a new power cable. So first thing to do was just to desolder. It's quite thick solder, so nice big thick hot iron, and then the solder melted fairly quickly, and just melting the solder away and applying pressure on the cable just to free it up. The flex goes into the machine with a little plastic grommet that I wasn't looking forward to. Very, very similar to one on a BBC micro power supply, and those things are a pain to get off. This one just came off really, really easy, so no problems at all with that. But that just clamps around the cable, so I just need to transfer that to the new cable. So I went into my bag of cables, found a suitable thickness cable that had cut off something a long time ago, threaded it through the hole, and pre-tinned the wires a little bit, and then just threading it here through the hole, just giving it a bit of heat just to melt the solder a bit, just to let it go through. Bending the cable down to the contact. I mean, the massive contacts here. This is not fine soldering at all. So there's loads of solder that I'm using. You know, just using all that old solder that's there. Just making sure that I'm happy with how it's sitting. And then I will top it up with some fresh solder. Once that's done, repeat for the other side. Obviously, live goes towards the fuse as it was before. And then put the little clip back in, slot it into place, and this little bit here is just held in with two small screws. So I'm just doing up the screws there. So screws go in, and then it's time for a test. So I plug it in, nothing happens. Press the power button, nothing happens. Just the thing is completely dead. Nothing that I can do will bring it back to life. As I said, I've checked the fuse that's in line there, and that's good. I can check the other side. I could put the meter on the actual fuse itself, and I was getting 230 volts, so I could see power coming in. But there's just no life in the system at all. So the first issue that I've got is trying to work out why I've got no power. So obviously, check the fuses. I checked 230 volts to the right-hand side of that fuse. So the theory was, let's chase the 230 volts to the transformer, and then let's see if I'm getting some low voltages out of the other side of the transformer. So the next bit then is to disassemble the case. And this, all the components are pretty much held together by that white plastic frame, and the actual, what you see, the frontage of the system is all one piece. So what you need to do is you need to basically take out the guts of the system in one go. They're held in by a number of screws around the outside of the frame, and also a number of screws that are underneath as well. So that's what I'm doing now. There's a really good, there's a half decent service manual on the internet for this thing that shows you the position of the screws that you need to take out. You also need to take all the dials off as well. So you've got a volume dial at the top, and the one that I'm struggling with is the tuner dial. And then on that flap down below, there's things like balance, mixing levels, bass, treble. So they all pull off, even the tuner one, you'll see eventually, but they all came off nice and easy, but there's always one, and my nemesis was the tuner dial. So I couldn't get it off. I pulled as hard as I could, it wouldn't come off. There wasn't really anything that I could use to lever it with, so I tried that, and I thought, well, I'm going to need something with better grip. And I was obviously concerned about damaging it. I tried a cloth. I guess ideally, there may be a special tool for it, but ideally if you had something like mole grips with that had rubber instead of metal, that might have done it. So, you know, if you could grip a piece of soft rubber around it, might be nice. But in the end, what I settled for was wrapping it in black masking tape and then using pliers. Now I did, even though I tried to be as careful as I could, I did actually scratch mine a little bit. I don't know if mine was just tougher than usual to come out, but I had problems getting it out. Me tackling the bottom screws. It's got a couple of legs with some screws on it and some additional screws as well, so they're all coming off. And then I'm taking the power supply out. Now I was quite careful here because that power supply has a board on it, and like most transformers, they're really, really heavy. So I didn't want to put any unnecessary stress on the PCB, so I was quite careful here. But eventually I got it out, and I was able to get a meter on it. And what I found is that I wasn't getting mains voltage to the transformer, which was strange, because I thought, well, you know, it's only a short bit of cable that goes from that fuse to the transformer, so what's going on? Have I got a broken cable? And on closer inspection and looking at the cable and moving it, I grabbed hold of the orange cable that goes to the fuse, and it just came off. So I had a bad connection between that orange cable and where it connects to the fuse. So I just stripped it back and resoldered it. Again, you know, it's don't need to be no need for any finesse here. Just nice big blob of solder on there, and it was good. Okay, repair is done. Soldered this wire to the fuse. I haven't put everything back yet. This is just all loose. Nothing is shorting. No. Okay. Right. Moment of truth. Let's plug it in. Is it going to go bang? Is it on? Is it? It didn't go bang. Oh, there's a light. There's a light. There's a light. There's a light. There is a light. We have power. Oh my god. Oh my god. We have. Sorry, focus. We have power for the first time. And there's another light. There's another light. There's another light. Where is it? I just saw it as I was moving around. There you go. There's another light in there. So we've got power. Whether it works or not, I don't know. Let's try it and see if. Oh my god. Oh. Let's get this up. Come on, come on, come on. Right. Can you see? We have a moving cassette. I think it's too much to ask to try and close the door. Is it going to fall over? Nervous about this. Can I zoom out? I'm really nervous it's going to fall over. I think that's. Maybe it's not. Oh! I heard it, but nothing's happening. Oh, I just saw it move. It's trying. Right, I'm going to turn it off. Happy. We've got power. We have power. Let's get it off. Right, so next step is I'm going to put this back together because I don't have any drive belts. So I need a I know this because I've seen it in bits. I need a belt for the turntable, probably a new belt for the door. Might as well replace the belts for the cassette player while I'm in here. But I just want to put this back together because I'm just worried about the stresses on this while I wait for the belt. So I'll put this back together, order some belts, and then we'll give it another tackle when the belts arrive. But that is amazing. I thought that, I mean, luckily it was I had mains voltage here, so I was starting to trace it through, and luckily the fault was at this end. Obviously if it's further in, it's going to take some more time to sort it out, but
Yeah, I thought that was going to be a pain. I thought that was going to take ages to try and sort out. That is amazing. Right, all the belts and take it from there.
Right, I need to move the record player now so I can change the belts. The belts have arrived. So the record player is held in with four screws. So I'm just going to undo those four screws and then slowly move the record player out from the front of the unit. It's held in by two connecting wires. It just needs to be unplugged as well. Once it's free, I'm going to get rid of the main unit as I don't need that for the moment. And I'm just going to have the record player on the table and just work on that. You also have to free the buttons as well. They're held on by two clips that they unclip really easily. That's the sort of soft touch buttons. This set here, just two clips holding that on. Unclips really easy, and then you've got the whole record player. Just look and see if the turntable turns freely, which it does. And all around the bottom of the record player, all around the casing, you can see the old deteriorated bits of rubber from the old belt. So now what I'm trying to do is work out how I'm going to replace the belt. So there's loads of other YouTube videos on this, and everyone talks about just how much work replacing the belt is. It's definitely not straightforward. The amount of disassembly you've got to do to get to this stage, and even when you're at this stage as well, there's still more to do. So I'm taking off the motor here, and you can see on the top part of the motor some old bits of rubber that's just caked in there, and there's just bits like that all over the place. I went for using this sticky stuff remover, soaking a bit of kitchen towel in that, and then just working away at it. Just over time, seemed to get it off okay. Again, just making sure it all turns freely, and then at the end of it, I also use some isopropyl alcohol as well, just to keep it nice and clean and remove any sort of greasiness that other type of cleaner has left behind. So I went for a combination of just trying to remove as much as I could to get this belt on. So the actual turntable itself is held on by a bracket with four screws. There's two at the top. You need to move some of the wires out of the way to access that. And there's two underneath this board as well. So you take the board off, and then you can access the two other screws. And that helps lift that whole deck out. At some point, I also thought I might need to remove that cap in the middle. But that isn't necessary. Once you've got these screws out here, there's enough give then to lift that whole turntable up enough to get the belt underneath, the new belt underneath that turntable, and then you can, there you go, so if you can lift the whole thing up, it gives you enough room to play with. So with that up, now I get the new belt, and I can slide that underneath now and get it to where I need it. So once it's in place and it's gone round the whole turntable, then it's a question of just manipulating it into place. So that belt needs to go and be stretched around the whole turntable itself. Took a little bit of time to do it. So what I decided to do is to lock everything back in place once I was happy that the belt was in a suitable position. Locked everything back in place, screwed everything back together, and then just wrestled that belt around the actual turntable itself. Then screwed the motor back in, and then finally just stretched the belt around the motor, and just checked that everything was spinning freely. I didn't capture it, but I also replaced the door belt as well. So in the top left of the screen, you'll see another motor with another belt. That's a lot easier to get to. There's a couple of screws on that motor. Undo that, lift the motor out, belt comes out, and then just replace that belt with a suitable replacement. And then what I did while I was here is I put some new grease. The grease actually wasn't too bad. I checked to make sure it wasn't too hard. Cleaned a little bit of it up, and then just put some new Molycoat grease on the plastic bits there that you can see in the left hand side of the screen. All those gears, that, all those cogs that that are critical for the door opening smoothly. So just put some new grease on there. Assembly is the same, just in reverse. So present the record player back up to the frame and secure it with the four screws. And then just look for those two cables that you unplugged earlier and plug those back in as well. Just flipping it round, I'm going to find the soft touch buttons, just clipping those back in. Nothing special there, they just push them back into the mounting points, and it's ready for testing. So I had a problem here opening it. It was working, it's just I wasn't used to the buttons. With the sort of the case off, the buttons just needed more of a press than I was expecting. So you saw me helping it there. It didn't need a help. It is actually working fine. But I'm learning about this. You know, it's been 40 years since I've used it last, so it's a little bit slower than what I was expecting. Trying it with a record now. So that top one is the open close again. It needs more of a firm held on press, and you can hear it click, and then it off it goes, it closes. Right, onto the cassette now. The cassette did actually work. The spindle's moving when I press the buttons, but you know, I've got it open. Hopefully, save me having to open it any time soon again. I might as well replace the belt. So there's one belt there that you can see straight away that winds on the counter, and then there's a further two belts behind it. And I took the approach to take this metal plate off, just being a bit cautious here. What I didn't want is for me to lift this plate off and just everything just ping into the air and have cogs and bits and pieces all over the place. So I'm just being careful. Once I'm happy, the plate does actually just lift off in one piece and exposes those two belts there. So just replace the two belts, give it a little bit of a clean where there was some old grease. The easiest way I found on putting that belt on was to put it around the motor first and then put it around that flywheel. Yeah, just give it a bit of a clean using some IPA, and then the other belt goes around that white wheel and around the top middle section of that metal wheel. Plate goes back on top, screws back in. And then you just need to wiggle it back in place. Now, one thing to be wary of, on that plate that you took out, that you might have noticed there was a little sort of shaft of a metal pin. That metal pin needs to go into a sliding switch behind there. I think it's the record switch, but it needs to go into there. If that doesn't work, either you won't be able to record, or I think you might always be in record mode. So just make sure that that pin goes into that switch okay. And I didn't show it on the video, but you might have seen the can of contact cleaner on the desk. While you've got it there, just spray some contact cleaner into that switch and give it a bit of a move left and right. You might as well while you're here. So now we're going to test the tape. I've only got one tape. This, I don't know what, where this tape's come from, but it was the only one in my drawer. So giving it a test now. No idea what buttons do what, and yeah, probably not a good idea to fast forward it while I'm not holding it, or there's no cover to hold it in place. But everything seems to work fine. And just because I was a little nervous about that record switch, I thought I'd also try and record from record as well. The reason I'm playing around with those buttons at the bottom is because I've got no idea, without the case on that tells me what they do, I've got no idea what they do. And I thought one of them may be an input select. It's not, but I thought I might as well flick them just in case it was an input select and it wasn't selected to record from the record. But when I rewind the tape, I can hear the recording back on the tape. So I know that recording is good. Just going to take the opportunity to clean the tape heads. So I'm just using a cotton wool bud soaked in isopropyl alcohol and just giving it a good rub and getting some of that old dirt off. So there's meant to be a light that lights the record player very subtly while it's playing. It's on the end of those two wires there. There's a little rubber boot that goes into a clip. There you go, it goes into a clip and then the light pushes through that hole and that light then shines onto the record. Now that bulb isn't working, and again I don't think that's fairly uncommon. So what I'm thinking about doing is replacing it with an LED. I want to give it a little bit of a modern twist, so I'm going to go for a blue LED. Now LEDs typically are around, well it depends on what colour, but around 3-3.5 volts. Blue I think is about 3.6 normally. So that first LED that I was using there was a 3.6 volt LED, just putting 3.6 volts straight to it. This one here, it's been brought as a 12 volt LED, but it's still a 3.6 volt LED. It's just got a resistor in place to allow you to run 12 volts for it. It's a bigger LED, so actually it fits in the hole perfectly without needing that boot. So I'm going to go with this one because it's just easy. I'm cutting off the boot here. I'm trying to get fairly close to the boot, but give it a little bit of wire in case I ever want to use it. Thinking about, can I put it there so it's if I want to take it back to original in the future, but in the end I'm just going to take it off and keep it with the machine. So there's not much to work with, but I've got those two wires there, and so I'm expecting them to be about 12 volts. So I'm just stripping the wires from those two, a little bit fiddly, just because of how short it is, but I'm just going to strip them back, and then I'm going to get the multimeter on it and just test which one's negative and which one's positive. And I went to look for the red tape, couldn't find it, so I ended up with the black tape. I'm just going to put some black tape around the black wire, but the one with the black tape shows me that that's the negative wire. So I'm just stripping the ends back of the wire, and I'm just going to connect them up. Weirdly, on this LED, the blue wire is the negative and the black wire is the positive. But I just want to connect them up, just a quick connect and do a quick test just to prove that it works. So the light lights up as soon as the machine is turned on. Interestingly though, when I measured the voltage across those two bare exposed wires, I was expecting to get 12 volts, but I actually got 8.5. You'll see it just in a bit. There you go, about 8.46 I think it was. So not quite the 12 volts that the LED was expecting. So the LED is going to be a little bit dimmer than what it could be. So I thought I'd take the opportunity to change the resistor. So this here I'm pushing from the bottom, that's the resistor that's in line with the LED that comes as standard for that 12 volt LED. I'm just measuring the resistance, and it measures 896 ohms. So the theory is, if I use a resistor with less resistance, then I should be able to get more voltage to the LED. So I should be able to get the full 3.6 volts that it's expecting. Didn't quite have a resistor as small as the original one, but this one's fairly small. This one's small enough. And did a little bit of quick math, I think that if I use a resistor of around 550 ohms, that should give me about 3.6 volts from that 8.5 volt. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put this resistor in line with the LED. So I've stripped the LED of the insulating wire. And you can just see a little stub there where it was connected to the old resistor, and I'm going to solder on this new resistor. Give it a tug test, that looks good, it's holding it tight. So now on the other end of that resistor, I need a bit of wire. So I'm just going to use the original wire, I've stripped it back a bit. This is the wire that came with the LED, and again just soldering that to the leg of the resistor. Another tug test, and that looks like it's holding tight. So I've trimmed off the excess leg that I don't need, just measuring up a bit of heat shrink. And I'll cut that to size. And that slots over the resistor quite nicely. So that should protect it, hold it in place a bit better, and then a little bit of heat to shrink the heat shrink. And just keep it all locked in nice and tight. So I took it back to the stereo, and just connected it up temporarily, and I left it 30 minutes. Just kept checking it, making sure nothing got too hot, and everything looked good. So what I'm doing here is I just had a thought that maybe the reason that it was only having 8.5 volts is because it has like an idle voltage, and then it jumps up and the LED gets brighter when the record actually plays. So I thought I'd play a record and just see if the brightness changed, but it didn't, so all was good. So I'm happy with that LED, happy with the modification that I'd made. So now I just needed to trim the wires off and solder it in place. Should have done this a lot sooner, just to protect the record that was there in case any solder did spit out and burn the record. But once it was soldered, last bit was just to carefully heat the heat shrink, and that's it, all done. LED fits nicely in the hole. Just tuck the wires in and then give it a quick test. There you go. That should do. So just want to give it another quick test, see look what a well-trained finger can do this time. Now I know how to press that button properly. I just wanted to see where we were, take stock. The light's very, very subtle. The kitchen's quite bright, but you can see it better when the lights aren't so bright, but everything works. Record sounded really, really good, so I thought that was it, but that wasn't to be the case. So what I noticed earlier on, and I thought it had gone away, is that I was struggling to get sound out of one speaker, and on investigation I found that although the record player was playing fine, anything else, radio, cassette, I was only getting sound out of one speaker. And it wasn't the speaker issue, because I swapped the speakers over and the sound stayed on the same channel, so the fault stayed on the same channel. When I moved the balance to one side, I either had all sound, and then when I moved it to the other side, I had nothing. And said everything, and it was the fault was on everything except for the record. I couldn't work out what it was. I went round the boards and pulled on cables and tapped a few things. I know I'd cleaned the, I hadn't mentioned it, but I also cleaned the pot on the volume. I didn't think it was that. I don't think it was the balance, because as I said, the balance was working perfectly. It was nice and smooth. There was no crackles. Just wasn't getting sound out one side. So I had a look at the service manual and tried to work out what was common between the record and the cassette, and I could not see a connection anywhere. So I reached out to the community, reached out to some friends in the local makerspace, and one guy, an electrician, had a look over it, and he said that he thought the problem was with the switches that selected the radio, the tape, the record. And I challenged him, said, well, if that was the case, surely what you're saying is that one switch is good, the record switch, and then all the other switches, the mono radio, the stereo radio, the tape, and I can't remember what the other one is, auxiliary. All those have all got faults except for one switch, which didn't sound right. But what he was trying to explain to me is that it's almost like the sound is routed through the switches, so you get one bad switch, and then everything then downstream of that is going to be at fault. So I said, okay, I'll have a look. So we started looking around the board where the switches are. I sprayed a load of contactina as best as I could. They're not the easiest switches to get at. Didn't seem to make any difference. And then while I was sort of faffing around, when I found this, and when I pressed on this part of the case, I got the sound out of the channel. So that sort of honed me in on that board. Then I got a bit of it's an old wooden paintbrush, and I started tapping around the board. And when I got close to the switches and put pressure on the board near the switches, the sound cut in and out. So it suggested that I've got a bad solder joint on at least one of the switches. So where I thought I'd be putting it back together, I was now stripping this board out to try and reflow the solder around that switch. And nothing's easy with this machine, and that top board wasn't easy to get out either. It wasn't so bad, but the thing that made it difficult is the bit of string that goes around quite a few pulleys that moves the radio tuning dial. I just thought, well, I couldn't get it out without not completely undoing the string, but undoing the string from around the pulleys. And I just thought this is going to be a pain in the ass to get back, but it managed it in the end. So what you can see here is I haven't pulled it all the way out. I've just got enough give on that string to give me a bit of space to work. So I pulled over the soldering iron and got a light, and what I'm doing is I'm just using some flux, and I'm covering all the solder joints for all the switches in flux, and then I'm going over them with the soldering iron and just remelting the solder. And then where it doesn't look too great, I'm just adding a little bit of fresh solder on some of them. So I went through and did all of the joints just on the row of switches at the bottom, and then I gave it a test. So I think finally, and it has been a bit of a journey, I think it is all there. So now it's time to see if I can remember how to put it back together.
leadership throughout this process. Just imagine what I can do with extra resources, investment, and your expertise.